Good morning.
Good morning.
A couple of weeks ago, I shared with you a message called Our Recklessly, Wastefully, Extravagant God. We talked about if you could make all the gold you wanted, would it be extravagant to pave your driveway and do your Arizona lawn with gold nuggets? No. So when we talk about God's extravagance, we're not talking about his material extravagance. We noted that religion, theology, Christianity has had a hard time with the extravagance of God. Seems like most Christians are either Calvinist, predestination, which means God is sovereign, he gets his way. If he died for your sins, you're going to heaven, whether you want to or not. Therefore, he only took to Calvary the sins of those he predestined to be saved. If you're not on his saved list, he didn't pay for your sins. Arminians, on the other hand, from Arminius, a guy in about the same time as Calvin, he dared to suggest that we had free will and that we actually got to make choices. But he still went with the sovereignty of God to the point where if God paid for your sins, you're going. So in Arminius's view, even though we have free will, Jesus died for the sins of those he foreknew would choose him. And I suggested that Adventists are one of the few in our world today that actually believe Jesus died for everybody's sins. Whether they choose or not is irrelevant. Because the cross is the new tree of life. Tree of life was removed from the garden. And at the cross it was re-erected. Which means because of the cross, you have choice again. Without the cross, we're all headed for death. All Satan can give is death. We ran off. Remember about 4 weeks ago we talked about how we broke up with God. That's what sin is all about, is breaking up with God. It's not primarily about behavior, it's about relationship. We broke off the relationship. There was nothing bad about eating fruit, and there was nothing bad about the fruit. The only thing wrong at the tree of knowledge of good and evil wasn't even that they disobeyed what God said. It's that it was their way of exercising their choice to run off with a different lover. And they ran off with a guy who can't give life. Kind of like, you know, the teenage girl who meets this man that she's so in love with. He doesn't have a job, doesn't have an education, doesn't have any motivation, he's high half the time. Oh, but I love him. You know, where are you headed? You look at your daughter who's going to run off with this bozo, and it's not going to come out good because there's nothing there. We ran off with the guy who can't give us life, which means the wages of sin is death. God doesn't kill sinners. Sin is killing us. God doesn't say serve me or die. He says you're dying. Serve me and live. You've heard those phrases hundreds of times in the last 20 years, I'm sure. When you run off with one who can't give you life, if you run off with someone who can't give you money, you're going to end up poor. If you run off with someone who can't give you life, you're going to end up dead. And all of Scripture is God pursuing us to return us to relationship. We have this idea that Scripture and the Gospel is all about God trying to get us to be good. Be as good as you want to, you're still lost. The original sin was not about what you did, it was about a relational decision. Therefore, the solution to sin is not about what you do, it's about a relational decision. And God's pursuit of us is not to get us to be good, it's to get us back into relationship, and relationship will profoundly affect our behavior. Are you with me? And what Jesus did at the cross, we looked at these verses, 1 Peter 2:24, he bore our sins in his body on the cross. Literally, he bore our sins. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he who knew no sin became sin for us. He became our sin. Isaiah 53, he bore the sins of us all. I think it's 1 Timothy, God desires all to be saved. Is God sovereign? Yeah, he can have anything he wants and do anything he wants. Does he always get his way? Well, then he can't be sovereign. Or can he? A sovereign gets his way, right? Have anything he wants. I believe God is sovereign, and I believe he doesn't always get his way because he sovereignly chose to give us free will. And so what he did at the cross was he sovereignly came and he bore the sins of everyone. Whether you like it or not, you've been saved. You just don't have to go if you don't want to. You've been saved, but you can die if you want to. You see, for God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever might, it's in the subjunctive mode, might believe. You don't have to believe. But if you choose to believe, no, I did that wrong. I have the grammar wrong. I'm sorry. I got to the subjunctive too soon. Let's start over. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever, while believing in him, that's an ongoing relationship. Trust is a relational word, not a behavioral word. And it's a present participle in the Greek. It means nothing to you, but it means an ongoing action that is contemporaneous with the main verb. Okay? So whoever, while believing, if you're back in that relationship, might not perish. You don't have to perish anymore. Before the cross, you had no choice. Your parents ran off with a guy who can't give life, and you're stuck there. But while believing in Jesus, you might not perish, but you might have life forever. So it's perish or life. And what did Jesus do at the cross? He reinstituted choice for all. You realize if Jesus only died for those he chose to save or those who would choose him to be saved, then the rest of the world doesn't really have choice. Because without the cross, you have no ultimate choice. You lost it at the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So at the cross, Jesus restored choice for everyone. And the only way to restore choice for everyone is to put salvation in the bank for everyone. Now you can choose. Before that, you're just headed for destruction. We're born dying. We're born on the Titanic after it hit the iceberg. We're born on the sinking ship. It may not be our fault the ship is sinking, but we'll be just as dead when it goes down. No matter how good we are on the ship, your behavior is irrelevant to what's happening with the ship. And if you're born on a sinking ship, you can be good or bad. In the end, you'll be dead. And the only thing is if somebody creates a lifeboat, so you have a choice. Now, you don't have to get in the lifeboat, but there has to be. Have you ever been on a cruise? I've been on two cruises. And before they even leave port, they get you all lined up and they put on your life jackets and you know where your gathering stage is at. And there are no more Titanics without enough lifeboat seats for the number of people on board. There has to be a lifeboat seat for every person on the ship. Otherwise, somebody wouldn't have a choice. So if Jesus at the cross didn't pay for every sin of every person who ever lived, then somebody wouldn't have a choice, and John 3:16 couldn't say whoever. It could say, all of those except this little group here might not perish, but might have eternal life. Are you with me? To me, there is no gospel in predestination. There is no gospel in foreknowledge. The gospel is the extravagance of God who chose to save absolutely everybody, whether you want it or not, and then chose to give you the choice of whether or not to receive it. Does that make sense? That's the extravagance of God. That's the review. See, I didn't get to preach the sermon at second service, so I'm not preaching the one that's in the bulletin. I was driving along on Thursday, and Patty needed a sermon title. I said, well, that's where I'm headed next. I forgot. I hadn't finished this one. So you're getting part B, and they're going to get the whole load at second service. God's love is extravagant. It's like the parent. If you're a parent and you have a child that dies, you can have 12 more children and have a happy, wonderful family with lots of kids, but there will still be a missing spot with the one who got away. Isn't that right? It doesn't mean there's no happiness. It doesn't mean there's no joy. It doesn't mean the life isn't worth living. It doesn't mean everybody has the blues all the time. But you can't ever replace a person. That makes sense? And I suggested a couple weeks ago, God can make more gold and silver. God can make more worlds. But there's something about being made in the image of God where God can never make another you. He could make someone exactly like you with the same thoughts and memories and everything else, but he would know it wasn't you. And God doesn't go around faking himself out. He's the ultimate truth. So he's not going to make a fake you. There will never be another you. And so he came to redeem all of you. All of us. And that's the extravagance of God. It's relational extravagance, not monetary extravagance. Now get this. That means, my favorite verse of Scripture, 1 John 5:11 to 13, this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life. And this life is where? In His Son. God doesn't give you a credit card that you can swipe and pay off the debt of sin every time you sin. What does He give you? Himself. Eternal life comes packaged in a person. How do you have a person? We're back to relationship, right? So we're just going round this tree again and again and again. In the beginning, the first sin was breaking a relationship. It had nothing to do with deeds. It had everything to do with relationship. But the broken relationship resulted in broken deeds. So how do you fix the problem? Fix the deeds? No, fix the relationship. So Jesus came and made it possible for us to all return to relationship. What happens when you fix the relationship? It'll fix the deeds. Behavior will follow. A real relationship will change your life. How much? God calls us to love with the same extravagance. Remember the disciples, they came to Jesus and they said, I think it was Peter, said, how often should I forgive my brother that offends me? Up to 7 times, Lord? I'm going to be really noble. And what does he say? No, make it 70 times 7. I don't think that means it's limited. I think that means you'll lose count. You better do another one. because you may not have gotten there yet. I also think it ties into prophecy where God, at the end of the Babylonian captivity, he gives the Jews 70 times 7 to the coming of Messiah. Chances, years to follow. He says, you give your neighbor as much as I gave you. That's the point. Jesus says, John 13:35, by this all will know you are my disciples if you love one another as I have loved you. Our love is to be as extravagant for others as his is for us. I've been working through the book of Matthew in my private time with the Lord the last month. Did any of you spend some time with Jesus this week purely for the purpose of deepening the relationship? That was the message of Lee Venden, right, in February? And I have to admit that I had kind of fallen off that wagon, too busy. And I made a commitment during that week that Lee was here to get back on that wagon. And I have been reading every day and spending time with Jesus for the purpose of knowing him. Sometimes 20 minutes, sometimes a couple of hours. Seems like the best time is about 3:30 in the morning. And then go back and sleep some more. But I've been working my way through the book of Matthew. And in Matthew chapter 6, actually, let's go back to chapter 5. The extravagance God calls us to. Verse 17, do not think that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I didn't come to destroy, but to fulfill. Assuredly, I say to you, until heaven and earth have passed away. That's kind of hyperbolic language, isn't it? Until heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or tittle will by any means pass from the law until all is fulfilled. The way that's written in the Greek, it means absolutely no way, never, never will anything pass away from what God has written. Whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever does and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. There's actually, in that verse 20, there's kind of a double superlative. You know, unless your righteousness extremely surpasses that of the most holy, meticulous, religious, Bible-quoting people in that society. God calls us to extravagance. He wants righteousness that is way out there. Or maybe I should say way in here. He doesn't just call you to be good. He calls you to be perfect. He goes down through and he says, I didn't say don't kill someone only, but if you even call someone an idiot or a moron. And by the way, the word, verse 22, whoever's angry with his brother, forget the without a cause part there. We defend it, well, you made me so mad. That's baloney, okay? And that's not actually very likely in the original text, without a cause. Probably got added. It's not in the oldest manuscripts. Whoever's angry with his brother shall be in danger of judgment. And the idea of that judgment goes back to the murder. It's capital punishment. And whoever says to his brother, Raka, will be in danger of the council. And whoever says, Moros, you fool, is Moros. From which I believe we get the English word moron. I meet a lot of morons when I'm driving. Have you noticed that? And I realized God doesn't want me calling people morons in the privacy of my own vehicle, because it has something to do with my heart. We'll be in danger of hellfire. God calls us to a radical kind of relationship, where he ends up saying in verse 6, anyway, later in the chapter, he says, love your enemies, and therefore be perfect like your Father in heaven is perfect. Does the same thing with adultery, does the same thing with marriage, he does the same thing with making oaths and giving promises. He does the same thing with helping other people out, even when they force us to help them, go 2 miles instead of one. And he ends up saying, not only should you not murder, should you not commit adultery, should you not break your wives or husband's hearts, or should you make big oaths so you can break them, you should love your enemies. Yes, therefore you shall be perfect. What does God call us to? Extreme. Just be like him. Anybody tried? How's it working? But if he gets in here, it comes out. Because Jesus says, out of the heart comes the evil, and out of the heart that's made new comes the good. Then he keeps going in chapter 6, where he talks about doing merciful deeds. Don't do it for your own glory. Do it for the glory of God. And then he talks about prayer. And I want to go down to verse 14. Right after the Lord's Prayer, I want you to notice these verses. If you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. What does that sound like initially? Conditional. You forgive? You forgive first. So you forgive him and you forgive her, and then I'll forgive you. But does that fit the gospel? No. That would be contradicting to what the gospel says in so many other places. He just forgave the world at the cross. Whether we forgive anybody or not, he forgave us. That's the extravagance of God. So what do you mean, if you don't forgive, he won't forgive? And I believe this verse is another example of the extravagance of God and what he calls us to. You see, God didn't forgive you. He forgave the world. We like to think of sin as deeds. So let's see, when Jesus went to the cross, you think about the sins in your life, and every one of those sins went on Jesus. May I suggest that sin is a broken relationship? Jesus bore the broken relationship between him and the world on the cross, and all of its consequences in bad deeds, yes. But the primary thing Jesus did was bear the brokenness of the world. And it's one for all and once for all. You see, I don't think what Jesus did on the cross was, let's see, you know, 1% of it was for you, and you're a worse sinner, so 3% was for you, 2.5% for Carl, you know. I see it as a lump thing, the whole enchilada. And in God's mind, it's not pieced out. It's for everyone. Which means, if you refuse to extend forgiveness, you are denying the presence of forgiveness. Because if you get forgiveness, everybody gets forgiveness. Right? If you get saved, everybody gets saved. And then everybody gets to decide. But if you get saved, everybody got saved. If you get forgiven, everybody gets forgiven. And for God, it's just one lump thing. He doesn't slice and dice. It is or it isn't. So if you deny forgiveness, you're denying forgiveness. You have to see the hand signals to get that. If you deny forgiveness, you're denying forgiveness. So if you deny it to somebody else, you're denying it to yourself because you're denying the whole thing. Does that make sense? It's all or nothing. It's not a little for you and a little for you and a little for you. It's extravagant, but it's indivisible. It's indivisible with life for all. So I believe what Jesus is saying does not counter the gospel. He says, if you get forgiveness, everybody gets forgiveness. So if you refuse to extend it, it means you refusing to receive it. Because if you get it, everybody gets it. So if you deny it to them, you deny it to yourself. It's not do it and then I'll do it to you. It says if you recognize what forgiveness is, period, you'll recognize that it's one for all and once for all. And if you don't think it applies to somebody else, then you automatically don't think it applies to anybody, including you. That's the extravagance of God. And he says, freely you have received, freely give. God calls us to receive his extravagant love and to let it flow right on through. And if we try to de-extravagantize it, like that word? If we try to diminish it, if we try to parcel it out, a little for you but none for you, he says you can't do that. It either has to, if it's going to flow in, it has to flow through. And if it's going to flow in unrestricted, and that's the only way I give it, it has to flow through unrestricted. And if you shut it off, you're shutting it off. So God calls us to the same level of extravagance towards others that he has shown towards us. What's the great commandment? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then the second is like unto it. You can't do one without the other. Love your neighbor as yourself. That sums up all the law and the prophets. Love is the fulfilling of the law. As we said over and over again back when we were doing Isaiah a couple years ago, love is not the motivation to keep the law. If you are loving God with all of your heart, soul, and mind, and loving your neighbor as yourself, you will be in harmony and sync with every law of the universe. Love is not what motivates you to fulfill the law. Love is the fulfilling of the law. And it's extravagant. It's so extravagant that several places Jesus says that our love for him is to be so extravagant that our love for every other person and thing is like hate in comparison to the love for him. If you struggle with those, you got to hate your mother and your father and your husband and your wife and your kids and your houses and land. Again, Jesus is talking in extravagant language. Our love for him has got to be so number one that everybody else is about number 210. He calls us to an extravagant relationship. It's kind of like marriage. Our relationship with our spouse should be so all-consuming. It doesn't mean we don't have any other friends. But there is a depth and breadth and height of the relationship with your spouse that no other friendship comes close. That's what he calls for. And then Philippians 2, verse 5, he says, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. What was it when Lucifer wanted to be equal with God? It was robbery. He was trying to take for himself something that was not his. And in this case, could not be his, because he simply wasn't it. You know, you can self-identify as a chicken all you want to. You're never going to be a chicken. We have a world that wants to think they can self-identify themselves as whatever they want. And I'm sorry, when you get all through self-identifying, you're still what God made you. I find it interesting, there was that white gal who'd managed to be the head of the NAACP in some place back in Michigan. And when they discovered she wasn't black, that she was white, they kicked her out, and she says, why? I self-identify as black. I guess you could self-identify gender, but you can't self-identify race. I'm sorry, God set her identity. Satan wanted to self-identify as God. He's been into this self-identification thing all along. He wanted to self-identify as God, and God said, there's only one problem. You aren't. I want to look at a lot of people who want to self-identify and say, well, you can identify anything you want to, but you aren't. Look in the mirror. Satan wanted to self-identify as God. God said, sorry, you're not God. That would be trying to take something that is not and cannot be yours. But Jesus didn't have to self-identify as God. He was God. It was not robbery. He wasn't taking anything to himself that was not innately his when he recognized that he was equal with God. But he made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a servant, coming in the likeness of men, being found in the appearance of man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross. That is extravagance. That's extravagantly all the way to the bottom. And what does he say? Let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name that's above every other name, extravagant, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, and those in heaven, those on earth, those under the earth, everywhere, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. But notice he says, that's my mind towards you. I gave it all. There's nothing left. And when you give it all and there's nothing left, that is extravagance. If you only have 10 cents and you give the whole thing, that's extravagance. The widow's mites. She just gave her two mites, but she gave the whole load. And Jesus pointed out her extravagance as opposed to the miserliness of the millionaires who put in a few hundred thousand. And he says, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Go out and extravagantly love others as I have loved you. All the way to, they love not their lives to the death. All the way to. If you're not willing to die for somebody, you really don't have any right to try to straighten them out. Have you thought about that? If you're not willing to die for somebody, you really don't have any right to try to deal with them. But if you're willing to give your life for that person, then maybe you're worthy to give some advice. I think we see that in parenting. Parents, for the most part, it seems, are willing to die for their kids. That's the whole parental love thing, which gives them the reason and right to raise them. God was willing to die for us. He says, I want you to be willing to die for each other. And it'll be the great evidence that you are my disciples if you have the same extravagant love for one another that I have for you. That's all he calls us to, is perfection in love. And the only way we're going to get it is if we spend time at his feet on a regular basis, soaking up who he is and letting him transform our minds. Romans 12 verse 2, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed. It doesn't say transform yourself. It's in the passive. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Can you renew your mind? No, we can mess up our minds, but we can't renew it. All we can do is put our minds on the Lord and the things of God, and that will have renewing power. Renewing power. So God calls us to the same extravagance that he has shown to us. And he says, come to me, I will transform you, I will remake you. And you can become the bearers, the livers, the sharers of my extravagant love on earth. Jesus, we thank you that you held nothing back. And I believe that as we behold you, we can be changed into your image from glory to glory, such that we can love like you loved. We can give that same extravagant forgiveness and care and love. But may we not forget that we can't produce it, but we can hang out with you and you can transform us and make us after your likeness. You can restore us through relationship such that our behavior will match the restored relationship. Thank you for making it clear that the work of God is to put our trust in you. Your work is to transform us into your image. May we do our work faithfully as morning by morning we spend a little time with you, sitting at your feet for the purpose of deepening the relationship. And may we get to enjoy seeing the fruit come as our lives trade in anger for love and kindness, and rough words for kindness, and bad habits for good ones. As you transform us, thank you that we get to experience the new life that comes from your extravagant love. We pray in your name. Amen.